It is the first Monday in October, and that means the Supreme Court kicks off its new term. The court will deal with several political issues, among them affirmative action, voting rights, and labor unions. For what to look for in the months ahead, we are joined, as always, by Marcia Coyle of the National Law Journal. Welcome back to the program, Marcia.
Thanks, Judy. It's good to be back.
So it is developing into a pretty big term.
It is, and not only with the cases that the court has already agreed to hear, but there are some big ones waiting in the wings that the justices are likely to add to this term's docket.
Now, you were just telling me that there's a lot of conversation, before we get into some of the specifics, that this, a lot of conversation about how this could turn out to be a more conservative term than last one. What did you mean by that?
Well, so much of a term's character depends on the nature of the cases that the justices take. But it also depends on if those cases are controversial and the court is likely to split ideologically. Justice Kennedy is in the middle. He's the swing vote, and he tends to vote conservative more than he does to the left on certain issues. And those certain issues are on the docket, as you mentioned, affirmative action, voting, First Amendment, unions.
Well, let's tackle a few of those, and let's start with affirmative action. Okay. This is Fisher versus the University of Texas.
Right. The University of Texas uses race as one of something like 17 different factors in its admissions policies. Its goal is to achieve broader diversity. This is the second time this case has come to the courts. Several terms ago, the court sent it back to the lower courts because it believed that the lower courts hadn't applied strict scrutiny. That is, that it hadn't found, it hadn't first looked at whether race-neutral alternatives were used by the university before using race. Went back to the lower court. The lower court once again said, this program passes constitutional muster, comes back up to the Supreme Court, and apparently there are four justices, because you only need the votes of four, who still want to look at the use of race to achieve diversity in higher education.
So, as you say, the second time before the court. Another Texas case, Marcia, this one on political redistricting,
right.
One person, one vote.
And it's hard to believe that the principle of one person, one vote is now before the Supreme Court in a very basic way. How should you count people in order to get to one person, one vote in legislative districts? The state of Texas, in fact, just about every single state counts total population in order to get to that. But the challengers in this case say, no, you really should count voting population, eligible voters. And the reason it has politically high stakes is, if you go with voting population, that tends to benefit rural areas where people do vote more, and they trend to vote Republican. If you do it on total population, which includes not only voters but non-citizens, they tend to trend Democratic in voting.
So you're going to capture a bigger group.
And, right, exactly.
Including, and it raises probably some questions about immigration.
Favors cities, yes.
So another case that we know is coming up has to do with public sector labor unions and individuals who are not paying members, dues-paying members of these unions, but who may receive benefits.
Well, back in 1977, the Supreme Court decided a case in which it had to strike a balance between the First Amendment rights of non-union members as well as unions' rights when they engage in collective bargaining. The benefits of collective bargaining also go to the non-union members. In the public sector. And the unions look at that as free riding. And so the Supreme Court said the First Amendment rights of non-union members really aren't hindered if they contribute to the cost of collective bargaining, but they don't have to pay for the union's non-collective bargaining activities, like political lobbying, speech, things like that. But in the case before the Supreme Court, the court's being asked to overrule that 1977 decision and eliminate the fees that non-union members pay to unions. So the stakes are very high for public sector unions, which remain the largest unions in the country.
Now, the other thing, Marcia, is you've told us there are a couple of cases that are, in your words, in the wings.
Yes.
Potentially really controversial cases.
Yes. There are two cases pending right now involving abortion clinics, and restrictions on how those clinics operate. This goes to the sort of heart of the abortion right. How do you determine what is an undue burden on a woman's right to abortion? Do these restrictions or regulations, are they an undue burden and thus unconstitutional? And then the second group of cases, there are seven of them right now, and there probably will be more, come from religious nonprofits who are objecting to how the government accommodates their objections to contraceptive health insurance.
Well, it's enough to keep you very, very busy.
Potentially a very big term, Judy.
Marcia Coyle, thank you. We look forward to seeing you again soon.
My pleasure.